I can't just let it go. I can't pretend it never happened and just move on with my life.
You don't have to pretend. Baby, you don't even have to forget. But it is what he wants us to do.
We begin this week with The First Step, the locally produced Christian film premiering Saturday at the Jefferson Theater. This is the story of a man who has his faith tested when he's forced to confront a personal tragedy. Congratulations to director Jerry Longcon, as well as the writers and the cast. This is a nice little film that deals with some difficult issues of faith. I'm a big fan of the screenplay, although I do think it could have been fleshed out a bit more at points. And how cool is it seeing local actors and locations up on the silver screen? Congratulations to all.
What is this?
It's a contest.
The best Gran Turismo players in the world get a chance to compete in professional racing.
Dude, this is real.
At the multiplex, Gran Turismo should take the checkered flag this weekend. The story of a video gamer who gets a chance to try racing in real life. This is a sports underdog movie with some nice moments of drama and exciting race footage. Plus, the real life story gives it some extra power. I'm not a huge fan of motorsports movies, but Gran Turismo was a lot of fun.
There is a bomb under your seat. If you... Do I have your attention?
Liam Neeson is back with another by-the-numbers thriller called Retribution. It turns out that somebody put a bomb in his car and is threatening to blow him up unless he does exactly what they demand. This is a bit of a by-the-numbers thriller, the type Neeson can do in his sleep by now. Retribution doesn't break any new ground, but I suppose fans should find enough here to get excited about.
But all I want to do is play. When I swing that bat, I ain't crippled no more.
The Hill tells the story of a Texas boy born with degenerative bone disease, but he wants to play baseball anyway, while his father thinks that his son has a calling to preach. The underdog sports movie here is quite moving, and the 1950s production design is well done, but the drama itself is a little simple. Still, it's easy to root for this underdog chasing his dreams.
Today, the Egyptian and Syrian armies launched an offensive against Israel.
Our enemies hoped to surprise the citizens of Israel on Yom Kippur.
Our troops are outnumbered 7-1.
If the Arabs reach Tel Aviv, Israel will be wiped off the map.
Fathom Events is screening Golda, the award-winning biopic of Golda Meir during the Yom Kippur War. Helen Mirren stars as the title character, alongside Liev Schreiber as Henry Kissinger. So as you might guess, this is a well-made, wonderfully acted movie about the important world leader. Credit the acting, the makeup artists, and the cinematography work here in this awards-worthy film that's only playing for a limited time in theaters.
Guys, I need you to be really cool. Can you do that for me?
Look who you're talking to. When have we ever not been cool?
Over on home streaming, Vacation Friends was a Hulu hit during the pandemic, so now we get Vacation Friends 2. The story of a nice couple who meet a crazy couple while on vacation and how they cope when the crazies follow them home. If you like the original movie, the sequel is more of the same. I enjoy a bit of cinematic mayhem with a feel-good wrap-up message from time to time, but this is a bit of a guilty pleasure for me.
My bat mitzvah determines the rest of my life, and I just think Dua Lipa would make the party perfect.
You can have a ball pit.
And finally, Adam Sandler and his whole family made a sweet family film. You Are So Not Invited to My Bat Mitzvah tells the story of two teenage girls who were fighting over a boy. Adam Sandler takes a backseat to his real-life daughters in this movie, which allows them to handle the teenage angst, while Sandler pops in for a comic crude comment or two. You Are So Not Invited to My Bat Mitzvah is a sweet look at teenage friendships with a heart-swelling moment at the end. Surprisingly, one of my favorite films of the weekend.
I know she hurt you, but I'm sure she misses her best friend.
And that's what's new this weekend in the movies. I'm Sean McBride, the movie guy.
Must be Friday.
Yes.
This guy showed up. Sean McBride, the movie guy, here to fill us in on what's new at the box office. And these days, also what's new at home. I mean, there was that time when you and I would simply talk about what's new at theaters.
Yeah, exactly.
But now we also talk about what's coming out this weekend that you can stream mm-hmm. in your own home. And
a lot of times that's the best stuff out those
weeks. It is. Yeah. And I would say we have seven to talk about this morning. Would I be right in guessing that maybe half of them are streaming?
No, actually, just two of them.
Really?
At home. Well, I thought that was kind of interesting. And it's weird because next week, really nothing at home streaming and only one film in theaters. But this week it's, you know, feast or famine.
Okay, but before we get into that, I think the place that we should start, because we always advocate shop local, buy local, Let's talk about a local film because coming up this weekend, there is an event downtown Jefferson Theater, and I think it is an event because it's local actors featured in a locally made movie.
Local directors, local writers, local composer. I mean, that is so cool here. Yes, we're talking, we told you about this last year, the first step, which is this locally produced film. If you wanted to go see it, you needed to have gone to their website and signed
up. Oh, it's already sold out.
Yeah, the Jefferson Theater is pretty much sold out. But I did talk to the director, Jerry Longcon, and he said, look, there'll be other opportunities. So if you want, go to Studio 220 Films. Plural films, and they can put you on an email list, and you can find out where you could see it. So, look, this is a film. Basically, it's written by a former colleague of ours, Brandon Newman, who used to work here. He wrote the movie, and he has written this interesting little Christian film. It is only an hour. It's a story about this guy. He meets this girl. They fall in love, but she really wants him to go to church with her because it's a Christian movie. And it turns out going to church is a pro thing in Christian films. And they have their, you know, his faith is built. Whatever. Tragedy comes in. I'm not going to spoil what happens, but tragedy comes into the relationship, and he has a crisis of faith, and he has to deal with issues of forgiveness. And I think that is actually a pretty deep subject for, quite frankly, a film that's just, you know, we're going to talk, for example, in a second about a movie called The Hill, which also has Christian themes in it. And I don't think they handled the Christian aspect of that movie as well as they do this movie. So I'm really impressed by the screenplay. So Brandon, good job here. I love the direction. I think it looks like a real movie. Yeah. You know, it doesn't. A lot of times I see movies and I have to judge them and I think, well, you got some of your shots in focus. No, this one looks like a professional movie. Really good job to Jerry and his friends. The acting, how cool is it seeing your local friends?
I know.
Friends?
I look up, I see Chad. I'm like,
There's Chad Ella Peterson. That's Joe's Mary Mulvey Hill. Yeah. And it's not just them. I mean, I think they both do a great job, but it's kind of fun. You're watching a scene and somebody walks through the background. Right. You go, oh my goodness, that's Bailey. Hi, Bailey. How you doing? Or there's Lainey. I mean, it's just kind of fun to see all those friends.
Well, you know, and I'll be honest, I mean, you know, you're very involved in the theater scene here. I'm not. But when I watched this clip, I was like, hey, they're actually pretty good, you know, because you've seen it. And it's that overacted, underacted, acting. And this really came across as pretty natural.
And this is a film that has some difficult acting, you know, issues in it because, you know, you have to deal with tragedy and whatnot. Right. And those are not things that, you know, some actors can't handle that. I remember I worked on a professional film where my editor sent me to look at takes, and I looked at 29 takes of a professional actor that you would know because we couldn't find a good take here. Right. So congratulations to the cast.
Absolutely.
They do a great job. Congratulations to the writer, to the director. I mean, I think this is really kind of a great thing. They're going to have a red carpet at 7.
Cool.
And then they're going to have the screening at 8, and it should be a fun night down at the Jefferson Theater on Saturday.
And I think this is the second local movie in the last couple of years that, you know, we've talked about. Yeah, Western was out, and then we come with this one.
There are a lot of short films that come out there. So certainly when we get to I-48, there will be a bunch of them. There are movies, but it's kind of nice to see a big one going for it.
So, all right. So that said, congratulations. Mm-hmm. And again, that's all coming up this weekend. Now let's jump into what else is out there.
Probably the big one is going to be Gran Turismo over in theaters.
Sure.
And this is a movie I saw about a month ago. And the thing I remember most is when I left the theater, people broke into applause and they really like this film. It's this underdog sports movie. It's based on a real story. This kid, he plays the Gran Turismo racing game. And they decided to hold a contest to see if any of these video game racers could actually race a real race car. And so this is something that actually happened, and this is the story of the kid who wins that competition. I like it. It's an underdog sports story. He comes from a working-class family, and his father, played by Jomon Hounsou, says, look, son, racing is a rich man's sport. That's not us. But he doesn't give up on his dreams, and he goes for it. It's got lots of, you know, it's easy to cheer for this kid. It's easy to get excited by the action. I'll tell you, I'm not a huge fan of motorsports, but this one had me completely excited about it. You know, exciting action, fiery crashes. And like I say, the people that, when I was coming out of the movie, they were applauding this film. So they really liked it.
Well, and of course, fanboys are going to absolutely love it. Gamers are going to love it because of what it is. But, yeah, we'll see how well it does. I got a feeling this will be number one, you think, at the box office without a doubt?
I think they're looking at maybe $20 million. Okay. It's not going to be a slam dunk, but it should do pretty well.
All right. Let's run through the rest of the others.
I guess the second one is going to be The Hill, which is that Christian film I was telling you. It's also an underdog sports movie. It's based on a real kid out of Denton. And he grows up, and he is born with a degenerative bone disease. And so doctors tell his parents, hey, you are never going to walk. And the little kid says, here, hold my sippy cup, because he's going to walk, you know. And he has braces. Okay, you'll never get out of the braces. And he knocks the braces off. And this kid wants to play professional baseball. And so he's growing up in the 50s and the 60s. And he's a great hitter, but his dad, played by Dennis Quaid, doesn't want him to do this. His dad believes that his son has been called to be a preacher, not a ball player. And he's a fundamentalist preacher who thinks that baseball is trivial. And so I love the sports aspect. I mean, we get to the point where this kid is going to have this big tryout in front of these professional scouts, and I think he's great. I love the period design. I love the acting here, with the exception of the Dennis Quaid character. For a film with so much Christianity at its core, it's an interesting decision to make the preacher the bad guy. And this is a father who does not support his son. And so, and we don't really get into his character, so we don't know why. He just comes across as a jerk until the end. I mean, you can tell where this is going. Right. And the end, they're going to have a reconciliation. But I don't think it worked. We were talking about this issue with the local movie that it's kind of a black and white thing. You know, well, I believe this, and I'm not going to brook any, you know, buddy coming up with a different reason. You know, I think the world is black and white, and I'm going to stick to my guns. And I understand it, but the world doesn't live in black and white. It lives in the gray area. So kind of a miss. I love the sports stuff, but I kind of hated the drama. And it pulled me out of the movie.
All right. Moving on. I hate to do it this way, but we have so many.
Retribution. We can do this one very quickly. It's Liam Neeson's latest movie. He's a guy. He's taking his kids to school one day, and he gets a mysterious phone call. Says, there's a bomb under your seat. And if you don't do it, I'm going to blow everybody up here. And you know, there's some masked bad guy that's trying to not only make him do bad things, but frame him. And so it's him playing a guy of a certain age who, you know, he gets mad when they threaten his family, and how is he going to get out of this, because he can't get out of the car or the bomb goes off. Reminds me a lot of Speed, obviously. It reminds me a little bit of Phone Booth, if you remember that movie. But, you know, this is Liam Neeson. He can do these movies in his sleep right now. And, you know, there are moments in that where, you know, like the beginning where he's hitting a heavy bag, and you can tell he just doesn't have the power to do that, you know. Wisely, though, he's in the car most of the time, so he doesn't have to run and beat someone up here. But it just seems like kind of a mindless...
You know what you're getting, though.
Exactly.
Come on. It's Liam Neeson.
If you're a fan of these movies, you'll be fine.
Right. All right. Next.
We should, and also really quickly, we should mention that Golda, which is Helen Mirren.
Oh, yeah.
Excuse me. That's playing in Fathom Events is doing that. And she does a pretty good job here. Obviously, she can act.
That's a given, so. Golda Meir.
Golda Meir, the story of her, the Prime Minister of Israel during the Yom Kippur War. That is history that I think some people have forgotten. So
I'm sure,
interesting.
Or never learned.
Yeah, precisely right. Visually wonderful. I think the makeup, I probably should not come away from this movie going, oh, those prosthetics looked amazing. But that was really impressive. And you know, she's always smoking, so she's always surrounded by a cloud of smoke, bad for you. Don't smoke, kids, but it sure looks cool on film.
Good movie,
but it's a Fathom event, so it's not going to play fully, so you'll have to go seek that one out.
I got you. Okay. Have to look for it.
Home streaming.
All right.
We're just tearing through these folks.
Yeah, so, got to.
So Vacation Friends 2, if you remember, the first Vacation Friends that came out during the pandemic, it's Lil Rel Howery and Yvonne Orji play a couple that go on vacation. They meet some crazy folks, and the crazy friends follow them home and put some mayhem into their well-ordered life. This is more of the same here. If you like the first film, you'll like this one, too. I'm not going to say it's a huge, it's kind of a guilty pleasure, but I appreciate a little cinematic mayhem. And this one, I think, continues that. I love John Cena in particular. He's so willing to poke fun at his macho personality.
Right.
I think he's a lot of fun in this. So more of the same. It's, you know, like I say, on-screen chaos, and it's fun. It's on Hulu.
All right, and we'll finish it up with?
If I can get through the last one. So, yes, the final one is actually a really wonderful movie. It's called You Are So Not Invited to My Bat Mitzvah. And this is an Adam Sandler movie. But wisely, it's not really an Adam Sandler movie. It's an Adam Sandler's daughter and his other daughter and his wife movie. And his daughter turns out to be a pretty good actress. Story of a girl, played by his daughter, and she and her best friend fight over a boy. She feels betrayed, and, you know, they're best friends, but, of course, they break up over the boy, and then, you know, it's about the power of female friendships, in particular when you're 13.
Well, wait. So this is his real
his
life?
His real life daughter, his daughter. Real life
okay.
wife.
Because I didn't know if you meant like his movie wife.
No, his actual folks. I mean, some people, you know, take your daughter to work day. Adam Sandler won that. You know, he took my daughter to work and he made a movie.
So. But is it a fictional story?
It's based on a YA short story. Oh, okay. And so it's you know, it's a professional thing. It's a drama. It's a lot of fun. They're playing these roles. I think they're very good. It's kind of hilarious watching these 13-year-olds who think they know everything, screaming, you know, I know these people. You know, I expect every parent will know these people too. I think it's a lot of fun. I think, and Adam Sandler's not really in it that much. He's really just there to throw in those caustic dad comments on the side.
I got you.
But it's his daughter driving the thing, and she does a very good job.
All right, again, Netflix, right?
Netflix on that one.
So there you go. You got something at home, something at the theaters. You can go take a break now, catch your breath, and then come back next week. You won't have to work too hard next
Just
week.
One movie next week.
All right.
We can come back and talk about some of these if we need to.
All right, sounds good. Thank you, Sean, as always. Sean McBride, the movie guy, joins us every Friday to talk about what's new at the box office and at home. Still to come this morning, got to find out what's happening in your forecast. Stay with us.